visual effects people, I'm AK, and this is the third video on driving Niagara with fluid simulation. And this is going to be the most boring video you have ever heard. So it's pretty much for those of you who doesn't like reading the documentation. By the way, it is linked in the video description. And please have a look at the short introductory video. So let's start. FluidNinja, just to shortly recap, is a tool to simulate two-dimensional fluids in Unreal and bake it in Unreal. And traditionally, we have been using these baked fluids on camera-facing planes simply by using a flipbook player materials. This classic use cases level is demonstrating examples for these flipbook playing things. And the new thing here is that we could use this fluid data to drive Niagara systems, since we have density and velocity, and we could sample these baked textures real time by a Niagara system. And so if you have a look at this picture, we have like a Y branching. After simulating and baking the data, we could choose using it traditionally on camera facing planes or mapping it on scene geometry, but it's really just a material playing a flipbook. And the second way is to sample the data in Niagara. Now, how do we do this? In the FluidNinja folder structure, in the core folder, you will find a Niagara subfolder. And we have basic emitters and custom Niagara modules here. The most important module is the FluidNinja multi-texture module. And it has three texture sampling pipelines to sample velocity, density, and real-time calculated shading data. And is outputting these texture sampled values to parameters available in Niagara systems. And so we could use it to scale particles, to influence particle velocity, or whatever parameter we would like to influence. I have to mention that Niagara also has a flipbook player functionality built into its module stack. But a thing is that the Niagara native flipbook player doesn't support frame interpolation. Now, why is it so important? Please have a look at these flipbooks. This one here, it's like 16 frames. This one here is using no frame interpolation at all, no frame blending. And as you could see, it's quite jaggery. And this one is using like a classical interpolation. And the third one is using the velocity data to interpolate, to blend between the frames. You obviously see that with 16 frames, the no interpolation method is producing quite a crappy outcome. So I prefer to use my own NinjaPlay way and use the velocity based frame blending. And this way, basically, we could have a very low number of stored frames, and this data that we are storing is typically in the 1 to 4 megabytes range. So it's a very low amount of frames, very few data. Anyway, so we are here in Niagara, and this is our base emitter, FluidNinja base emitter. And in the use cases folder per Niagara, you could find level 1, 2, 3 systems. These are the Niagara systems populating or demo levels. So let me quickly jump on the first demo level and pick a system that is sympathetic for us. Right, here we go. This is a very simple system. We have this density information playing here. And we are sampling this density information to scale the mesh particles vertically. So I'm just pressing play and having a closer look. Now, how do we do this? Well, first I'm clicking on this Niagara system container, going to the details, checking the Niagara system template, browsing to it, double click, and having a look of what we have. Right on. So here is our here are our mesh particles. As you could see, we have this module stack, and in the module stack, in the particle update group, so on a per frame basis, we do this texture sampling. And as you could see, the velocity and shading slots, user parameter inputs are empty because we are sampling only density, which means that only this pipeline, the density pipeline, is active, and on a per frame basis we are capturing a frame of the actual flipbook and forwarding it to Niagara, and the Niagara system is using this information, which is this Niagara multi-texture model is outputting, to scale mesh size. As you could see, the scale mesh size module is reading the output of the Ninja multi-texture reader. So that is how we inject this flipbook information into the system. We are sampling the texture with this module, and then we are using that data by various modules in the stack, in this case scaling the mesh size. So returning to this example here, yep, it's very simple. So it's just a simple channel of data and it's monochromatic, but still it looks good. And with using fluid simulation could result realistic and stylized results. Yeah, as you could see, so many ways to go. As opposed to our simplistic system in the corner, we have this guy here. And have a look, I'm moving these sliders, moving the main light source on the stage, and the system is responding, because it is using a real-time ray marching shader. As you could see here, we are using velocity data, density data, and the real-time calculated shading, and we are combining all these to have the final result. Having a look at this module, we are using all three pipelines to get this result. And now it is time to mention that we are not using our Niagara systems directly. We're not placing these Niagara systems directly on the level, but we are using a container blueprint. In the use cases folder, Niagara subfolder, you could find this FluidNinja Niagara system container. Now let's have a look at this. What is the purpose of this blueprint? Well, I was preparing the whole project as a demonstration. So this blueprint is to represent your game logic, because you're going to put your Niagara systems in game and you're going to drive them with your control classes, be it an actor or an actor component or a C++ code. But anyway, what we are doing is setting initial variables. This reinitialize is needed, because we have to use temporary data to have an editor preview, and when we start the whole thing playing in editor, so basically we are leaving the standard editor view and entering the game by pressing play, then we have to reinitialize these variables. So these are performed in the beginning, and here are the on-tick processes. First, we are generating three render targets for the density, velocity, and the shading pipelines. You could switch these on and off by bool flags. And then optionally, when the shading pipeline is on, we could calculate lightning. Now, how does it occur? It's very simple. We are having the position of the light source and the position of the system, the Niagara system, and we are making a vector, and we are just transforming it with the system transform, usually rotation, and that gives us a vector that we could feed into this material that calculates the Raymarch shading. Having a look at that material, just a second. Here we go. It is in the FluidNinja per core per Raymarching. Raymarch shader basic. It's a very, very simple material utilizing this single node, the Raymarch hade map node. And here's the parameter that we are feeding. It is called light direction. And so we are feeding our blueprint calculated light direction into this material. That's the story shortly. We have one more feature worth to mention. We could switch on camera facing, and this group of nodes is calculating that one, but it's not very interesting. So have a look at this. Again, it is just to simulate your gameplay logic and give you examples for functions, how you calculate some things, how you prepare variables for your Niagara systems. Well, what else should we talk about? I guess that's the core idea. And you would ask why do we need this blueprint with the render targets? Again, I have to repeat that in my opinion, this velocity-based frame blending is very important, and so it's like I'm pre-sampling, preparing these flipbooks with these player materials and writing them to render targets on a per-frame basis, and then I am feeding this data with this draw material to render target node into the render target, and I am sampling that render target in Niagara. In case if you don't need frame interpolation, and in that case you could use the Niagara native flipbook player, and then you could skip this whole part with the blueprint and the render targets. One more thing to mention, and we have been talking about this on the demo levels as well, that it is an option. It is up to you how you would like to use the various pipelines. Yeah, by the way, if I click on this blueprint and I go details, let's have a look at the details panel. We have three group of parameters: Niagara params, helper function, and blueprint params. The most important is Niagara params. This is how you provide a template for the blueprint, how you define certain colors needed for ray marching, and how you enable or disable the pipelines. You also provide the player materials here, in this case only velocity player material. In the helper functions, you could switch on and off level of detail and certain dynamic functions for camera facing and light behavior. And in the blueprints, you could set like light attenuation, overriding material, flipbook material, play speed, stuff like that. Have a look at the documentation, it's really boring. Okay, returning to this system. So this one is using only velocity data, and the density that we are utilizing is a classic painted texture. And let's have a look how the emitter looks like. I go to the details panel and the Niagara params. I search the Niagara system, and here we go. Here we are in the Niagara editor, and here is the multi-texture reader. And as you could see here up at the user parameters, I'm feeding this density texture directly into the system. So I'm not using the pipeline, the density pipeline. I'm just assigning the single texture in the Niagara system. And in the case of velocity, I'm using the pipeline, so I'm feeding it with a dynamic material on a per frame basis. And so this velocity information changing on a per frame basis is like washing away this density data. So I guess it's a really good way to combine classical textures and fluid simulated data. Right. Well, we have been talking about pipelines. Yeah, we have to talk about emitter types. So most of the emitters that you could see on the example levels are using this simple volume emitter, which means we are outputting the particles using a grid or a box or a sphere, a geometric primitive, and we are generating the UV coordinates based on particle position. And it's a very simple way to generate mesh particle position and UV in the same time. But we have two more ways to go. One is to use a static mesh, and we are spawning particles on the static mesh surface. In this case, this is this arched, this curved surface, and we are using the static mesh UV to map the fluid simulation on the particles. And yeah, this looks ugly. I might have a better example. Yep, this guy here is a little bit better. This is like a large egg, and I'm using the UV space and the geometry of this egg to map these particles onto the surface. And in the case of this smoke column, I do the same thing. I'm mapping these guys on an arched, on a curved surface. Well, anyway, returning to the third kind of emitter, so that was the previous was the static mesh surface. This is skeletal mesh reproduction sprites. This is how the epic guys call these. And the point is that no texture sampling occurs here. It's like slicing the whole surface into pieces and applying these UV islands onto particles. And it looks nasty if I move a bit closer, but it might be a good way to do a surface aligned fluid simulation on moving objects like characters or animated things like skeletal meshes. Yeah, those were the emitter types. So we were talking about pipelines, emitter types, and in the previous video, we had an important note on using velocity on an additive way. So please have a look at that video or the documentation. I'm not going to explain this right now, but the point is that looking at these two examples, at the top one I'm overwriting particle velocity, and the bottom one is like adding this information to particle acceleration. Again, it's just a question of Niagara Systems setup. Having a look at this system, by the way. Here we go, level one systems, and this guy here. So, what makes this velocity thing additive? Well, again, here is the multi-texture reader and is outputting velocity. And here is acceleration module. And I'm simply reading in this three-channel velocity data by the acceleration force module. I'm applying some drag, and the solver does the rest. So that's it. That's the story shortly. The takeaway message is that while Ninja Classic was providing you with this pipeline, this data, this working method for creating flipbook textured simple geometric planes, now we have this alternative, this option to drive Niagara systems. But both options are valid, and it is up to you which you would like to use. So shortly that's it, and thank you for your patience. And it's my daughter crying again. That's a classic trademark for these videos. So see you next time. Bye bye.